Our guest this week on ANN is Tam Fowles, and we're going to talk about compassion, we're going to talk about South Africa, and we're going to talk about community cohesion in Britain today. Based in the southwest of the United Kingdom, Tam Fowles works across the UK and internationally. Tam is the founding director of Hope in the Heart, which designs and delivers personal development workshops and courses, including the Accept Perspective, a model she developed herself to help survivors of emotionally traumatic experiences to find better ways to cope. After a lifetime working as a therapist, group facilitator, and inspirational speaker, Tam has spent the past year living and working in the townships of Soweto in Africa and created many collaborative relationships with NGOs across South Africa. Welcome back to the English Hour on ANN Satellite Television. It's good to be here, and it's good to have you with us. Our guest today is Tam Fowles. And she's from Hope in the Heart, which is a wonderful organisation, wonderful thing to be from. Tam, thank you so much for being our guest.
It's really thank you for having me.
Well, splendid. We've got three subjects, and the three subjects are, well, the first and foremost is compassion. Second, we're going to talk about South Africa. And third, we're going to talk about Britain and community cohesion in Britain. In today's world, where there is so much loss and suffering, there is an acute need for compassion within communities when it comes to overcoming suffering. The remarkable capacity of the human spirit to overcome suffering through compassion is evidenced by the reaction to the aftermath of war, whether in former concentration camps in Germany or in Hiroshima in Japan, or indeed in the human response to the latest pictures of the Syrian war. The determination of human beings to overcome such traumatic atrocities is inspirational. Hope in the Heart Accept model for coping with trauma is based on acceptance, community, compassion, expression, purpose, and transcendence, and helps people to overcome challenges they have faced in life. So Tam, where do we begin? Compassion. We're talking about not just compassion, but we're talking about the work of Hope in the Heart. We're talking about the Charter for Compassion. We're talking about all of this. And the world is, it's funny, isn't it? The world is a broken place, but and we always dream of a more perfect world. And compassion, is it right to say compassion is love in action, I suppose, isn't it? Is that right?
I would say so. I think there are a lot of ingredients to compassion, actually, and identifying compassion as a concept is quite a valuable thing to do. So I tend to think of compassion as being composed of a number of virtues, so virtues like tolerance, acceptance, love, generosity, service, and many more. But I think different people have slightly different recipes, and that's fine. I think compassion can be a bit of a subjective term, but generally, yeah, I think love in action is a really nice definition.
Well, brilliant. So, and tell us a bit, I mean, obviously you work for, well, you are committed to the Virtue Project. Mm-hmm. You run your own Hope in the Heart
social enterprise,
right, group, and you're also a signatory of Charter for Compassion. I mean, how do we get our heads around this? Let's start. Where should we begin? Should we begin with Hope in the Heart?
I think that's a good place to begin.
Right.
I mean, tell us a bit about that and where, and why you set it up and what it is.
Okay, so Hope in the Heart is a social enterprise, a small NGO, which was originally founded right at the very bottom of England in Cornwall 4.5 years ago. I had quite recently been made redundant from the project that I was managing before that, and I had been involved in working in the voluntary and community sector for many years with many different kinds of groups. I'd also been a therapist, a private therapist, working with people who had a variety of challenges. And right from childhood, actually, I had my own challenges in childhood, and I was always, right from the age of 9, interested in how people, certain people, could transcend adversity. When I was 9 years old, I was taken to Germany. My father had just recently died, and my world had been devastated, and I had an uncle who lived in Germany. And we went on a family holiday, and we were taken to all sorts of lovely places, Hanover Zoo, where we saw a penguin with a wooden leg, and up into the Harz Mountains, which were beautiful. And then we went to Belsen, to the concentration camp, which was strange. It was a strange place to take a 9-year-old child. There was just this palpable air of grief, tragedy, devastation, and it felt like home to me, because what had happened in my life, I couldn't make sense of it, and I really couldn't make sense of how people were going about their business, you know, other people, as though nothing had happened. And there was something about being there. It was a pivotal moment in my life. There was this sense of, okay, this is right, you know, this is how it should be, because the world is such a cruel place. The most profound experience I'd ever had by that time was realizing that people survived, that people went through these incredibly traumatic, unimaginable hardships, and they came out, and many of them went on to be very proactive. If people can survive something like that, then I can survive whatever it is that I'm experiencing.
It's powerful. Well, you're not Jewish. This is just resonated for you as a human situation, and vast tragedy, of course, probably the greatest act of inhumanity, single act of inhumanity in the 20th century. And we're facing a world that's broken now. We have the troubles in Syria and so many other situations.
So, Tam, fast forwarding to now, I mean, your Hope in the Heart. What drove you to start Hope in the Heart?
Okay, so as I said, I was working sometimes as a therapist and often in the voluntary and community sector with people from different vulnerable groups. And I realised that there were certain people, I was working with a lot of people who had challenges, who'd experienced hardship, and some of them would carry on with their lives as they had been. Others never really overcame what had happened to them, but there were certain people, relatively rare people, who I observed becoming more proactive in the world, living more richly, although they never, you know, it doesn't negate what happened to them, and in some ways they never left that behind, but somehow they managed to use it as a fuel to make meaning in their lives. And I was very interested in how that happened. I wanted to know, you know, how is it that certain people are able to do that? And what if it was possible to teach people to do this?
Yeah, to overcome, in a sense.
Yeah, to transcend. It was about becoming something more than they possibly would have been if they hadn't had the experiences that they'd had, and living more richly and contributing more to the world.
So people face a challenge and that knocks them back, and then they, instead of being knocked back by it, they move forward in a better way.
Yeah, I mean, they're knocked back by it originally, and they might be reeling for 10 years sometimes, but then something happens. They find the light at the end of the tunnel, and they find a way of using whatever it is that happened to them for their own healing, but also for the greater good.
And this is the work of Hope in the Heart.
So this is what Hope in the Heart is all about. I wanted to work out how people could be facilitated to, rather than just stumbling upon this, to reach that place. So I started looking at the common criteria among people that I observed who, at first I called them exceptional survivors. And I came across a lot of people in very different contexts. And it was when I was working with combat veterans as a therapist and group facilitator about 5 years ago. And really looking for a way of helping them to find meaning in what they'd experienced. And at the same time, my oldest daughter had moved to Japan, and I went to visit her in Tokyo. And we went to Hiroshima.
Oh, yes.
Because she wanted to take me to visit a beautiful island, Miyajima, which is just off the coast of Hiroshima. But I was involved in the peace movement in the 1970s and 80s, and I was very aware, obviously, of the atomic bombing. And I was quite apprehensive about going to this place because I thought it was going to be dark and nothing would grow there and people would be very bitter. And that would just be really depressing. Mm. And I was just amazed to find myself in this incredible, beautiful, vibrant place where certainly in the centre, the epicentre where the bomb exploded and everything was instantly vaporised, there is now a peace memorial museum, a peace memorial park. There are statues everywhere to the people who died and the people who didn't die. I mean, everything is about remembering what happened there. There's no sweeping it under the carpet. But there is such a sense of purpose, of reconciliation. I mean, it's beautiful. It's on a river delta. Mm. There's five rivers and they were all lined by autumn trees when I was there. And we went, my daughter and son-in-law and I went to the museum. Looked around and I was just more and more, obviously it was incredibly emotionally affecting on many levels, but the thing that really affected me was the palpable sense of reconciliation, of forgiveness, of the people who had put the museum and the park together, putting their hands on their hearts and saying, this is the part we played in this. You know, there was no sense of blame. Look at this terrible thing that was done to us. That spoke for itself. It was as though what had happened there was bigger than any recrimination.
So then there's a lesson then for example, I mean, many people who view this would be in the Middle East, and we've seen all the Middle East ripped apart in recent years, Syria, Libya, and so forth, and many wounds still bleeding. What are you saying in terms of, I mean, what are the, in terms of if you are suffering, so what's the magic formula? You're talking about people of Hiroshima having a sense of forgiveness. Mm-hmm. You're talking about your work in Hope in the Heart in the Southwest, where you're trying to help people who've been through trauma and to find something greater in their lives. Is there, I mean, it's if you're talking, if one of the viewers of this program is traumatized, as some may have been through because of the Syrian war or whatever, displaced. So what, is there something you can say? This is it? This is the way you should deal with your situation? Is there?
I can't say there's any magic wand, and I wouldn't begin to suggest that anything is going to be easy. I have never experienced trauma like people, you know, like I see on the television every day when I look at Aleppo, for example. I would say that the pictures of Aleppo are very similar to the pictures of Hiroshima after the atomic bombing. And I went back, I went to Hiroshima, 70 years after that happened, expecting it really not to look that much different. And it was absolutely transformed. And it gave me, it just made me aware that, you know, if devastation on that scale can in 50, 70 years be, I don't know, I think the people in Hiroshima would say that it wasn't healed. There are still wounds. There's been a kind of rebirth. Mm. It will never be like it was before. But it gave me a sense of, you know, if a community, if a country, if a huge city like this can experience that devastation and come through it with this amazing sense of the need to move on and make sure it never happens again, because that was the other sense. There were hundreds of thousands of people still survivors of the atomic bombing in their 70s and 80s and 90s working for a peaceful world. Mm. So there was this must never ever happen again. And these people had devoted their lives to ensuring that that would never happen again. So I wanted to ask the survivors, because I couldn't imagine what it would be like to come back from a trauma like that. Mm. I wanted to ask them, how did you do it? To me, it was miraculous.
And did you get her?
And I did. I talked to them about how it had been, and obviously they weren't okay in 5 minutes or 5 years or 15 years even. Mm. Many people were severely traumatized for many years, and it took a long time before they were able to even come out of their houses and talk to each other about what they'd experienced. But they were asked to. People from America particularly went into Hiroshima and said, look, we need you to talk to us about what's happened here so that we can ensure that it doesn't happen again. And gradually people started coming together and talking about what had happened amongst themselves. And then they started to go out and talk to the rest of the world. And I asked them what the process was that led to them being able to do this amazing thing mm. for the rest of the world. So as a result of this, I put together a model which has six components. It's called the ACCEPT perspective, and it's based on what I was told in Hiroshima, what I've been told by other people who I classed as exceptional survivors. And these six components are, the first is acceptance. And that is not a kind of light-hearted, oh, it's okay, these things happened, but I'm all right now. It's more, they were devastated. They were reeling for a very long time. Mm. And eventually, they found themselves in a position where the ground stopped moving underneath them, you know, and they were able to stand and say, okay, this happened. It's been terrible. How do I move forward? And so that's what I call acceptance. It's not this sure. happened and everything's okay. It's this happened, you know, recognizing that whatever happened, it was terrible. I don't have to get over it. I might never completely get over it. I probably will never completely get over it. But how do I move forward in the most proactive way? What do I do now? So that's the first stage, being at that point sure. where they're no longer reeling and they're able to say, what now? And then it's about, so the ACCEPT perspective, ACCEPT is an acronym. So we've got acceptance, community, compassion, expression, purpose, and transcendence. And I discovered that there was it's a spiral rather than a circle. So after the acceptance, I'm here, I am, what do I do now? Finding a way of being in community. A lot of people will withdraw when something terrible happens to them, they'll become isolated. So finding a way of being in community, and often that will be with a community of people who've experienced something similar. So for example, it might not just be people who've experienced conflict coming mm. together, but that's often the case. It might be, there might be a rape crisis center, women who have experienced abuse coming together in order to just empathize with each other and be able to talk about their experiences in a safe environment. The safe environment is very important. Alcoholics Anonymous is another example of people mm. who've experienced something and are looking to move on, and they will come together and share their experiences. That is often the first step.
Acceptance, community, then compassion.
Yeah, compassion really comes into all the other components. So, self-compassion, first of all. Often when we talk about compassion, we think about being nice to other people, looking at what other people might need. Self-compassion is really important. What do I need? How can I be gentle with myself as I move forward. And if I am moving into a community where other people are injured or broken as well, how can I be gentle with them? How can we be compassionate, loving, tolerant, understanding towards each other?
So acceptance, community, compassion.
Expression.
Expression.
So expression is about telling your story and being heard, which is important. So, you know, you can go out and tell your story. If people don't listen to you and hear you, it's not so powerful. But I found that people who have experienced something traumatic, whatever it is, need to be able to express what they've experienced. Often they don't feel that they can, for whatever reason. When I was working with combat veterans, they often felt that what they'd seen, what they'd experienced, was so terrible that they couldn't burden anyone else with
that's
that.
That's a common reaction, isn't it? Yes. How interesting. I've noticed that in others that have been in war, particularly military people that have been in fighting situations and have had their lives really threatened. And initially, anyway, some of them start, once they start talking, never stop talking. Mm. But initially, there is a complete inability to talk about the situation, the circumstances.
There's often a feeling that other people won't understand, or you know, they'll think it's awful. Sometimes people have done things that they, you know, they can't live with in a combat situation particularly, and they really need to tell people. There's a fantastic project called the Welcome Project, or the Welcome Home Project in the US, where very skilled facilitators bring combat veterans and their families together. And they have a long kind of retreat where they encourage people to, the traumatized people, to talk about what's happened amongst themselves and in a very safe, held, facilitated environment with their loved ones. And they encourage them to express themselves through art, poetry, whatever. And then they have a community event where people are invited to, ordinary people in the community are invited to come and listen. Just in a, they'll have a theatre and they will invite the participants to talk about what they've experienced, to read their poetry. There'll be an exhibition of their art, and strangers will come and listen in a reverent way, in a compassionate way, and they'll hear these stories. So and people get better.
So acceptance, community, compassion, expression, and
purpose. So as I said, often I observed that people who had experienced extreme hardship would eventually move on to do something proactive in the world. Often they will use what they've experienced. So in Hiroshima, for example, the survivors of the atomic bombing formed a peace culture and they dedicated their lives ensuring that nothing like that would ever happen again.
So acceptance, community, compassion, purpose,
and
transcendence, which is the last of the
And that's really, that's about having some kind of spiritual connection, whatever that might be. Again, often when somebody experiences something traumatic, they may have had a faith, they might lose their faith. They may feel very much disconnected from everything else. When I was working with combat veterans, I was working with an organisation that took people with PTSD, combat veterans with PTSD, surfing in Cornwall.
PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder.
Sorry.
Okay, no.
And they were able to transcend their reality by getting out in nature, getting out on a surfboard and experiencing something greater. So it's about connecting to something greater, whatever that is. It might be a religion. Quite often it will be something like nature or art, beauty, music. But finding something that transports you, that you can feel I'm not just confined to this reality where this happened and you know, I feel boxed in and I'm never going to get out. It's something that tends to happen organically.
Wonderful.
As a response to all of these
summarize then, acceptance, community, compassion, expression,
purpose,
and then transcendence.
Wow. Which leads you to another level of acceptance. Yeah. So then you go around the spiral again.
We're going to have to We have to pause there because we need to move on to our next subject.
Okay.
But really, thank you. That's interesting. And well, bless you. We're going to talk about South Africa.
The love and compassion expressed by the South African people is testimony to the generosity and kindness which still exists in society. South Africa, and indeed much of the world, is deeply troubled and polarized, and there needs to be more true commitment to making the world a better place. There is an acute need to establish and sustain cultures of compassion locally through initiatives in education. South Africa is a country that has made significant steps since the end of apartheid in 1994. Although vast levels of inequality and racial segregation still exist today and affect so very many people, reconciliation is vitally important for the South African people. Through dialogue and discussion, South Africa can yet become a more united society.
So, we're going to talk about South Africa, a place I've never been to, but I know so well, but through the television, through friends, and what a poignant place. I remember there was a man, I had a dear friend who, a priest actually, who used to work near Table Mountain. He came back from South Africa, I mean, this is years ago, in despair, thinking there was no hope. And then we had a resolution of everything, or it seeming resolution of everything. But the problems go on, don't they? I mean, you're very involved in South Africa. Tell us a bit about your work there.
I have been working on and off in South Africa for about the last 18 months. And I went there almost by accident on my way back from Botswana. I flew to Johannesburg, and I thought, I'd like to know more about what's happening in Soweto these days, because I was involved in the anti-apartheid movement again in the 70s and 80s.
Right.
And then obviously there was the rise of Nelson Mandela and all that fantastic stuff that happened there. And I thought, you don't hear much about what's going on in Soweto anymore. So by that time, I was quite involved with Charter for Compassion International, which is a wonderful network of networks, global network, which has partners all over the world, all dedicated to restoring compassion to the hearts of their communities. And I made contact with someone in Johannesburg through that, who introduced me to someone in Soweto. And I ended up going there for 8 days initially and staying in the townships in Soweto, which is very, very unusual for a white person to do. I hadn't realised how unusual. And I was apprehensive. I thought I might not be welcome. I thought that was perfectly reasonable, actually, given what those communities had experienced in the recent past. But I was very interested. So I went and stayed with an African family in a traditional house. And I have never felt so welcome anywhere in my life. It was just the most amazing experience. I was literally embraced by people on the street who were just delighted that a white person was willing to go and stay in their community. There were flocks of children every day outside the house. I did art and reading and things like that. I'd taken some books and some art materials with me to Botswana, where I'd been doing workshops beforehand. And I was kind of saying, why am I so welcome here? You know, this is what, and they said, it's Ubuntu. Ubuntu was a word that I'd heard, but I didn't really understand. And I experienced it viscerally. Ubuntu is an old African, South African tradition based in the Zulu and Xhosa cultures. And it is about valuing community over everything else. The philosophy is that if one person in my community is not okay, then I'm not okay. There's a lovely saying, which I can't remember in Zulu. I really must memorize it. But in English, it translates as I am because you are.
And the problems are still there.
The problems are huge. The inequality is unbelievable. And there is a lot of unrest happening now. I've seen the change since I first went there. Actually, there's been an uprising again over the last year and a half. So the universities now, there are riots at the universities. They're closed a lot of the time. That's about the fact that black people can't afford to be educated because the fees are so high and the discrepancy in income is so huge. But I wanted to learn more about Ubuntu, and I wanted to introduce that concept to the West because I think there's a real need for it, and it ties in so well with the work I was doing around compassion. Mm. It was also this year is the 40th anniversary of the student uprising, which turned the tide on apartheid, and I was very interested in how how young people had made such a huge difference. You know, in 1976, 10,000 young people marched to protest the fact that they were going to be taught in Afrikaans. They weren't going to be allowed to use their own languages or even English in school anymore. And that was kind of the tipping point for them. And they marched peacefully to protest this incredible oppression that they had been suffering for so many years, and their families and ancestors had suffered. And, you know, as we all know, that resulted in many years of violence. The police opened fire on the crowd, and everything kind of erupted. But that also resulted in the incredible reconciliation process that Nelson Mandela was very much instrumental
in. And you're an advocate. You feel it was some people really feel that the truth and reconciliation process in South Africa was exemplary and should be copied in Iraq and indeed, if we ever get there, in post-war Syria. And some people say, well, it doesn't really deal with the problem because the problem is still there after you've come to some sort of confessional forgiveness for the person that's done wrong. You still have this burden. I mean, what's your feeling about that?
I have mixed feelings about that. I think it's all very well for me to go in with my idealistic head and heart and say, oh, look, isn't this all wonderful? It wasn't me that experienced the oppression. Many people are very angry. They feel that Mandela sold out and there should have been a civil war. This is something that's coming out now, 20 years on. I always feel that dialogue and communication is the way forward. I can see why people resort to violence, but I think there has to be another way. I don't think it's enough to say sorry and this is what happened, and I think amends need to be made. And I think going to South Africa and seeing the inequality that still exists, it was very shocking. It's stark, it's unacceptable, and I don't think the Truth and Reconciliation Commission process was enough. I think there needs to be something which facilitates an equal society. You know, the poverty that I saw in the townships was incredible. The levels of despair, the commitment to making something of their lives among the young black people. I particularly was working with young people who've grown up in the townships, and they really want to make something of their lives. They're so dedicated to their education, and they can go to university. A lot of the young people I met had been to university and they'd had a taste of what life was like outside the townships, and then they go back and they can't find any work.
Actually, in many countries of the world now, we're getting a subculture of the comparatively poor and another subculture of the ultra wealthy. And this gap is getting bigger across the world between the ultra wealthy and the poor. But which is concerning. But is the problem entirely economic? It's not. I mean, obviously, there's an economic issue about employment, about unemployment, and disempowerment in that sense. In the South African equation, is there something beyond that? Because you have the black-white thing, don't you? So it's not as if it's one. You could say it's one culture, but it's not one race.
Yeah, yet. It doesn't feel like one culture.
No,
either. I think it's very early days. I had to keep reminding myself, you know, it's only been 30 years, less than 30 years. And it takes longer than that for a society that has been as troubled as South Africa has been for so many generations to change. I experienced at first hand a reluctance amongst the white people that I met some of the white people that I met to recognize the need for equality. I found there was still a huge amount of really insidious racism. There are also lovely white people who do what they can to support the people in the townships, but you know, how much can they do? I mean, to me, I always see things very simplistically and very ideologically. I don't have a brain for politics or economics. And I just kind of look at a situation and think, look, there's loads of people that have got loads of money, and there's loads of people who've got no money. So those people need to share with these people. And obviously that is very naive and...
No, not necessarily.
But I also think it's a no-brainer.
But there's an underlying issue here. Are you... what is your perfect world? Are you an integrationist? In other words, do you believe, it's talking about South Africa, do you believe in a future for South Africa 2 centuries from now where it's all coffee-coloured people, where they're all integrated,
No.
where it's one society? Or do you believe in separate but different?
I think it would be a real shame to lose the cultural diversity that there is in South Africa. That was something that really struck me in the townships. Again, there are 11 official languages in South Africa. In the townships, you have, originally there was a lot of divisiveness, which was facilitated by the apartheid government, keeping the Zulus and the Xhosas and the Sotho people apart. Now, people live hand in hand, next to each other. They all speak each other's languages. Obviously, it's not all rosy, but huge progress seems to have been made in the black communities where people are integrating, but they still have their own culture. And I was fascinated to learn about the differences between the Zulu and the Xhosa culture, for example. Those are the two main cultures in Soweto. And I think it's really important for people to maintain their cultures. There are very beautiful traditions that need not to be lost.
I can see that up to a point. I mean, you get the you get various models. You have the French model, the American model. The French model is total integrationalism. The American model is integrationalism, where you have one ideal society, but essentially you still keep a little of your own culture, you know, the Latinos or the Arab Americans,
yes,
or whatever, but basically they all buy into the same American dream. I like integrationalism, but you get many advocates of we got to keep our own identities,
yeah,
very strongly. So Syria should be Druze and Alawite and Christian,
yeah,
and Shiite and Sunni. Bothers me a little.
Yes, that bothers me as well. The important thing is to accept, respect, tolerate each other's different ways. And I think, you know, wherever you are.
We're going to have to move on, just okay, because of the limits of time. And our third subject is community cohesion, with particular reference to your own work. So we will move on.
Okay.
Thank you. Community cohesion in Britain remains a problem.
Tam Fowles started to work in this field in Cornwall, a very insular British county with a very homogeneous population. Some areas of Cornwall have voiced concern over migrants coming to Cornwall and disrupting the community. However, minds are changing and there is now greater acceptance within the Cornish community of the idea of welcoming migrants and refugees. Catastrophic humanitarian events, particularly the European migration crisis, have led to people in the local community wanting to create change and accommodate these refugees. Cornwall's campaign for more refugees to be accepted and the work of Cornish refugee charities such as Shelterbox may yet become an example to Britain as a whole. So, Tam, community cohesion. And Britain, we come back to Britain, really, because we need to kind of focus a little. And the Southwest, and, well, Britain as a whole. But have we, well, we haven't got community cohesion. We've got fragmented society with many different problems on many different levels, because we've had problems with xenophobia, with hatred of the other, and that's, what is there? What's causing that? I don't know. I think it's happening everywhere. There's more and more nationalism and ultra-nationalism and the kind of nationalism that divides us up so that even Britain is divided by heavens. We've both lived in Cornwall and we have Cornish nationalism. There's plenty of Cornish men and women who want to be separate from England, our viewers would be surprised to know. So it's becoming a feature of life. But that's not exactly, well, you tell me. I mean, community cohesion, what do you mean by it? Where does your work come into this?
My work really started in West Cornwall, which is, Cornwall is the little bit at the very bottom of the UK, which looks like a stocking. Yeah. And it's very different from the rest of the UK. It's a unique place. I actually ran away to Cornwall during a crisis 25 years ago because I didn't want to be part of the rat race anymore. I wanted to be somewhere that was slower and more laid back and beautiful. It is incredibly beautiful in Cornwall. It's a peninsula, and I think the word insular often comes up. People feel, in my experience, often very much cut off from the rest of the country as well as the rest of the world. There is not a lot of cultural diversity in Cornwall. Most people are white and Christian, if they follow a religion. And I, as I say, I've worked with a lot of vulnerable groups. I've worked with people with mental health issues, substance misuse issues. And I discovered that there was huge fear around this feeling of being cut off from the rest of the world. So people were seeing terrible, terrible stories in the newspapers and on the television about what's happening in the rest of the UK, what's happening in the rest of the world, and feeling as though that's nothing to do with me, there's nothing I can do about it, and yet it's coming to get me. There was this feeling of, you know, any minute now, this it, could come and get me. So, and that it, in the last 2 or 3 years particularly, has focused on people of other nationalities, particularly since the European
referendum. Yeah.
No, the one before that, the European elections.
Okay.
2 years ago, but very much particularly since the European referendum, this fear which has been fueled by the British media of the other coming into our community, our nice, safe, comfortable, beautiful community, and changing it, and taking my job and taking my house, all these things that people have heard.
And this is, I was, because my family is Cornish, and I know my own grandmother never, for much of her life, never moved more than 20 miles, more than 10 miles from her home area, close to Penzance, to the town of Penzance. So she'd never gone up to the rest of Cornwall. Extraordinarily insular little lives that people have led, and some people still do. I could easily, my children were brought up in Cornwall, and some, not all, but some of their friends have never been to London. Mm. And we're talking about this generation.
Yes. My children's friends too.
Yeah, astonishing, really. So a very isolated community. Mm. And this fear of the other, it's very interesting, isn't it, with the Syrian refugee crisis. Mm. The demand that from the government that each community take in a few Syrian refugees. And Cornwall, which is technically the poorest county in Britain, but anyhow, Cornwall praised itself greatly for taking in three refugee families, as if this was something exceptional. It's astonishing, really.
Yeah,
I mean,
it is. It's a bit shameful, really. But and it's been a very interesting time in Cornwall because the apprehension about taking in these three refugee families has really rattled. I discovered the whole county. You know, there were people who were horrified about the fact that we were even going to be taking in three families. But then on the other side of that, I have seen the biggest swell of compassion that I've ever experienced, I think, amongst ordinary people who saw what we see on the news, who heard about what people were experiencing and who wanted to help. And having been trying to get things moving on a grassroots level in Cornwall for many years, it's very difficult, actually. There is this insularity. People are often very involved in their own lives. Mm. There are big distances between people, lots of space, and it's a very different culture from the rest of the country. And I found it frustratingly difficult to galvanize people for causes that I was interested in. And what I've seen happen in West Cornwall particularly, which was where I was living in the last year, has been absolutely phenomenal. The way so many people have rallied to support in whatever way they can. So the support for the three families that were coming, although there were many people who were all doom and gloom and, you know, this is the top of the slippery slope and we shouldn't let anyone in because otherwise more are going to follow. But then there's been this other side. It's been a real polarity, this other side of what can we do to help? Raising money, preparing the houses,
and going raising into money
schools.
For Syria.
And it's going on all the time. I have I'm a member of a lot of Facebook groups which are around support for refugees, Syrian refugees in the southwest, and people are constantly going to Calais and Lesbos to be on the ground to support. People are constantly appealing for sleeping bags, food, so that they can fill vans and take them out there. People are campaigning for more refugee families to be allowed to come and live in Cornwall. There have been huge campaigns for unaccompanied children to come into the southwest. I heard this morning actually that the Plymouth Council have agreed to take 70 unaccompanied children on a temporary basis, which is something.
Yeah. And indeed, I mean, some of the big charity, well, one of the Shelterbox, for example, is Cornish, which is established in Cornwall, which is doing huge work with refugees and one of the better charities. So there is this compassion and there's this fear. There's a fear of the other combined with a great compassion for the other.
Yeah.
Which is a paradox, but actually quite understandable. Well, understandable. It's the way people are, isn't it? People feel compassionate but are frightened.
And I think the answer, you know, we talk about compassion and the different elements of compassion. I think empathy is an answer, and the way that I've been working over the last couple of years in West Cornwall is with these groups that I've talked about that are very fearful, particularly people who have emotional and mental health problems, telling the stories of people, the human stories of people who are maybe refugees or who are in war zones. You know, this is this person, and this is what they experience. These are their children. These are the things that they like to do. I started off doing that, and then I met Amina, who you also know, Amina Khalid.
Absolutely, and she's been interviewed on ANN.
She's a young Somali woman who was a refugee at the age of 13, came over in a boat, and she's been coming down to Cornwall, and we've been working together. And I think just the two of us, you know, a young Muslim woman who has been a refugee and a middle-aged borderline Christian English woman working together, we're setting an example. But we've gone into some schools and we've talked to children about, you know, what is all this about refugees, and talking about home. What is home? What do we mean when we talk about home? How must it be for someone whose home, you know, using a slide of Aleppo, for example, whose home looks like this? They want to be there. That's their home, but they have to leave. There's nothing left. You can see why they can't stay there. And then they come to another country, having lost everything, and they're told to go home, which was Amina's experience. She came to the UK having left everything behind. Absolutely traumatic journey, and she was told, you know, we don't want you here, go home. What must that feel like?
You believe ultimately in an inclusive society in which we all place an equal value on one another, in whether we're talking about Britain or we're talking about South Africa or we're talking about the world as a whole. That's the bottom line. We all should have equality, I guess, of opportunity, to use an old-fashioned phrase, and we should all value each other equally. I mean, is that how you would sum up your ideology?
I can't help being idealistic. That's my ideal picture.
Well, bless your heart. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for being our guest, Dr. Ham, on ANN Television. It's really great.
Thank you very much for having me.
Well, bless you. So, compassion, we've been talking about compassion. And is it a better world? Are we getting more compassionate? I think in many ways we are. I still believe that in this internet world, in this Facebook world, there is less xenophobia. And there will be less xenophobia, there will be less hatred of the other. It's a reality, I think. I think this next generation will be a generation that has more hope in its heart. I certainly believe so. I think the world will be a less painful place because of social media, because of the inclusivity, because we're moving away from the old hatreds, because we are all part of one world community. I hope you believe that. I certainly believe that. I think we're moving towards a better tomorrow. Better tomorrow for Britain, for South Africa. And the work of people like Tam Fowles, with her project Hope in the Heart, is actually very important. It's part of what moves us in the right direction. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for being our guests on ANN Satellite Television.